Hello, Tribe. We're back here today with special guest Mike Costo, and today we're going to be discussing Anjing Gembala Panchatsi Lat, which is a system of martial arts developed by Guru Costo. Mike, how are you doing today?
Excellent.
Great. Mike, now, for the audience at home, let's give them a little bit of an introduction. If I may ask you to give us a little bit of background about yourself, how you got involved with the martial arts, and the things that you trained in prior to creating your new system.
Okay. Well, I started as a kid in the spring of 78, and I started in training in Taekwondo, and unfortunately, because of a couple of traumatic experiences in the 80s, my memories are of exactly when what happened when are somewhat fuzzy sometimes. So I forget exactly when my Taekwondo instructor, her name was Melinda Bear, and she was an excellent instructor, but she moved away and had to quit teaching, and I'm not sure exactly when that was. I would guess 81-ish, maybe 82. After that, I went to another Taekwondo school. I didn't like it. And then I went into Okinawan Goju-Guru Karate. And I trained in that until 85 or 86, when my parents, it would have been 86. When my parents pulled me out, I was a freshman in high school, and the karate classes were interfering with my schoolwork and stuff. So they pulled me out, and then I spent the next 7 years getting together friends most weekends. We'd get together, and I would train in whatever they were training in, and they would share with me what they were learning. We would spar. And during that time, I was exposed to a wide variety of other martial arts, like Aikido and Kendo and Kenpo and et cetera, et cetera. And in 93, I decided I wanted to get back into formal training. And by that point, I was living on my own. I was working a full-time job. So I wound up going back to Okinawan Karate, Okinawan Goju, because all the stuff I had been exposed to, none of it had suited me any better than the Okinawan Goju. So I went back to the Okinawan Goju, and I trained in it until 95. And in 95, I was introduced to the guy who would become my primary instructor. His name's Ken Pinnell. And for a few months, I trained in both Goju and Ken's system of Sikal. And then I... due to circumstances beyond both of our control, I had to quit training in Goju. But my instructor, his name was Sean Larry Davenport Sr. We parted on good terms. We're still friends and still talk on occasion. I visit when I'm in the area. But I focused on the Sikal. I trained in Sikal, and Sikal is a hybrid of Silat and Kali. It has a strong influence from Inosanto blend, and then for the Filipino stuff, and on the Silat side, Inosanto introduced Guru Ken to Paul de Tours and Herman Sawanda, and he went and trained directly with them to expand his own understanding of Silat. So that forms the sort of core, and Guru Ken trained in other arts after that, and they influenced Sikala after as well. But the Inosanto and Bukta-Nagara and Mandi Muda formed the core elements of Sikala. I trained in Sikala from February of 95 through formally training anyway, June or July of 2010. And then due to a whole lot of things the best summary of it would be growing pains in Sikal. there was a lot of things kind of going wrong or whatever, and so quite a few of us sort of broke off and did our own things. And I'm still on good terms with Gurkin. We're still friends. I still train with him when I'm around, you know, in his area. But since 2010, I have been focused on developing my own system, which is Anjing Nimbala Pinchak Silat. And I almost never actually say the full name because eyes tend to glaze over. So I almost always refer to it as just AGPS. And it is based on, most heavily on the Sikal that I did for 15 years. But I also trained a lot with, I trained with Willem de Twars for 8 years. I trained with Victor de Twars for a couple of years. And I have trained at seminars and in private and semi-private settings with a variety of other instructors in Silat. And all of that sort of influenced my AGPS. And then another system is called Shin Chuan, and it's a Chinese name, and it's not Silat at all, but it had a significant impact on my overall understanding and my expression. And then Tai Chi has had a significant influence on my Silat expression over the past, 10 years, since I started attending an annual retreat in Sedona. So yeah, that's how I got from point A to point AGPS, I guess.
Now, Mike, let me ask you this, and this is not a criticism because I've done something similar and a lot of the members of the tribe have. But, you know, I meet two types of martial artists for the most part. And when I say martial artists, I want to clarify instructor level or above that
right.
are either, you know, like card-carrying members of their system and they're going to wave that flag till the day they die, or we have people that will branch off and do their own thing and create their own curriculum. What about your martial arts experience and your journey in training led you to want to establish your own curriculum as opposed to falling in line with an established curriculum?
Well, that's a good question, and to do it justice would require a long explanation, but I'll shorten it as much as I can. Gurkin's primary passion was and still is blades and blade training and blade work. And I enjoy blades and blade training, but my passion from day one with Gurkin was the Silat and the balance disruption, especially the balance disruption sweeps and takedowns. And so when I started teaching on my own, I was using the Sikal curriculum, and this would have been 2000 to 2010. And any changes Gurkin made, I brought them into my own training and implemented them and I taught the Sikal curriculum. But over time, during that 10 years, I started gradually departing from the exact format of the Sikal curriculum. And I started bringing out the Silat aspects earlier, the balance disruption, the sweeps, takedowns, et cetera. And I started bringing those out earlier and shuffling things around. And somewhere around, I would guess, 2005, I started asking myself, at what point of deviation from, like, this is, you know, this model here, model A, is Sikal. And what I'm teaching is deviating more and more from that. And at what point of deviation is it actually disrespectful to call it Sikal? And I was still struggling with that in 2010. Although I think I was pretty close to the point of saying, yeah, at this point, I should really either call it, at least call it, a variation of Sikal as opposed to calling it just Sikal. And then things got shaken up in the Sikal organization in general, And I just sort of went, okay, fine. I guess that's my cue. I'll go do my own thing. But really it had its roots in, that was sort of the impetus that sort of drove me over the line to making that decision. But I was already heading there because every year I was teaching, you know, what I taught had moved a little farther away from what the curriculum Drew Tin was teaching. That's probably the shortest explanation I can give.
So this was very much a matter of self-expression for you then?
Totally, yeah, completely. I've always felt this way, or at least as far as I can remember as an adult, felt that martial arts is more than just fighting. You know, that's the martial aspect. But the art aspect, I've always felt was just as valuable and valid as the martial aspect. And the art aspect, just like any other art, in martial arts, we're expressing the art through the medium of martial, through the medium of fighting or movement or whatever. But just like any other art, whether it's writing or sculpting or singing or dancing, whatever, it's about self-expression. And if all you ever do is mimic what you were taught, then it's possible to find self-expression in that. Just like, you look at like Liberace, how Liberace would play, one of Mozart's sonatas, and you look at how like Elton John would play it. They're playing the same music, but each would express it very differently. So it's not really about traditional versus modern or whatever. It's really you got to find that self-expression. And for me, that wound up meaning AGPS.
Now, Mike, tell me about AGPS, because this is not a sport art, and I think there's something that's very relevant in just the name. Could you tell us about the translation of the name of your system? Because I think that gives a lot of insight as to what the role of the system is and what your goals are with it.
Yeah, definitely. The name in Indonesian, Anjing Gabala Pencak Silat. Pencak Silat is a generic term in Indonesia for martial arts. But Anjing Gabala translates as sheepdog or guard dog, or if you were to say German Shepherd, as in the breed of dog in Indonesian, it's Anjing Gabala German. And I specifically chose that name based on it was inspired by an essay by Lieutenant Colonel David Grossman. Titled On Sheep, Wolves, and Sheepdogs. And in that essay, he uses those archetypes to explain society. So most people in society are sheep. And in the essay, he clearly states that it's not a derogatory term. It's just the archetype. And that sheep cannot harm each other except by accident. And that has its own nobility to it. And then there are wolves who prey on the sheep, and then there are sheepdog who protect the sheep from the wolves. And if there's anyone who hasn't read the essay who's listening, I would highly recommend it. You can find it pretty easily online on Lieutenant Colonel's Dave Gerson's website at killology.com, killology.com. Or at least it was out there the last time I checked. And it's an excellent essay that covers a lot of interesting ground. But that essay, it chimed strongly with me because all my life I have been I found myself drawn to protector type roles. So, my first fight was when me and two of my friends caught the class bully out behind the school in kindergarten and beat the crap out of him. and then moving forward, by the time I was in second grade, And I was undersized, overweight, redhead, glasses, freckles. So I dealt with bullies pretty much from day one. And so by second grade, I was giving other kids pointers on dealing with bullies. By the time I was in sixth grade, I was actively interceding. And so I would go to the bully and say, you got to cut this out. This kid is going home in tears every day. And then as an adult, that led to working security gigs and working as a bouncer and things like that, or helping people out just as a good Samaritan if I saw them in need. So the motto for AGPS is training for protection of self and others. And while in part I do mean, you know, protecting yourself from an attacker or whatever, I also see it as being broader than that, because I realized, I don't know, probably 10 years ago, that I don't actually teach martial arts or self-defense. Those are aspects of what I teach, but what I really teach is I teach people about their body and how to use their body and move it in healthier ways, and that leads to better coordination, better balance, which means people are less likely to fall, which means people, if they do fall, are less likely to get injured from falling. So the protection of self and others goes way beyond just fighting, even though that is an aspect of it as well.
Now, Mike, on the mechanical level, what are some of the unique principles that a person can see in your art? And see, when they look at it being practiced, if they watch the instruction, you know, if you had to explain to somebody else, which you are, you're going to explain to the whole audience here, but if you're going to explain to somebody else some of the key principles of your CLOT system, what would those things be?
The way I personally describe what I do at this point is I fill empties. And by that I mean, if someone's punching at me, for instance, their fist and the line of the fist is coming on is full. So I move offline into the empty. Then I extend my hand and I move it. I fill it empty until it's no longer empty, which means I've struck something, right? And I just keep filling empties until the threat is neutralized or until I walk away. And that's sort of one of my guiding principles. For me personally, that's my main guiding principle. Some of the others that I use that sort of help get students to that understanding are things like motion is motion, which is the idea that if when I'm looking at someone else teaching, I don't watch, I don't try and mimic their motion or think of it as something separate, something independent of what I do. What I watch is how their motion is similar to my motion and what I do, and then whatever they're doing, I can learn from, and I can use it to expand my understanding of what I already do. So even if it's something that seems very different from CLOT, I can watch it and go, okay, this is how they're using that motion, and that motion is here in my CLOT, which means I can use that motion the same way they're using it in that context. Understanding that I don't know, it's a lot of the stuff you hear from other people. It's just my way of phrasing it. So, you might hear, there's nothing new under the sun, or you might hear, as long as we have two arms and two legs and one head, there's only so much we can do with those tools that's either protective or defensive, protective. Whether it's to protect yourself or to attack. Those are sort of some of the guiding principles that I use. And then one that I mentioned in in the talk about Roadhouse is if I have to physically interact, like physically deal with someone in a violent situation, my intention is to keep them in pain and off balance from the moment I touch them to the moment I stop touching them. Another thing, I'm sure it doesn't differentiate AGPS from all other martial arts training, but it does differentiate it from a lot of the other martial arts I've seen, which is I have talked to a lot of people and done a lot of my own research into the legalities of self-defense. And as such, one of the things I routinely tell people when we're training and they ask, well, what do you do after that, whatever I've done? Maybe I've done a sweep and put, they've hit the ground. Maybe they're off balance and stumbling, maybe whatever. And my question is, why do you have to do anything else? My objective is not to punish them for attacking me. My objective is not to beat them down. My objective is to go home and be safe with my wife, preferably without a visit to the hospital and preferably without a pending court date.
Well, yeah, Mike, and knowing you and having worked with you a little bit, one thing I took away from my interactions when we got to train together a couple of years ago here in Chicago is that you're a big, powerful guy, and you would have no problem relying on, heavy strike. I mean, I could easily see you, doing something like boxing or, maybe a hard style karate. But one of the things that I drew away from my interaction with you was how much of a specialist you are when it comes to balance and the disruption of balance, understanding it. I found it very profound, and I want to applaud you for that because I think your understanding of it is excellent. And,
thank you.
That's something that, again, being a big, strong guy, you would have, you would think that a smaller, person, a lighter person might be the specialist when it comes to that type of fighting. But I found that that's something that definitely was a strong suit with you. And I find it interesting, that that's a big part of your CLOT curriculum.
Yeah, I the reason that CLOT attracted me initially, when I met Guru Ken, my primary instructor, Ken is 5'8" and 130 pounds. So he's a relatively small guy. And he was throwing people around, like causing them to crash to the ground. And these guys he was throwing around were as big or bigger than me. And at the time I was 250. And one of these guys was over 300. And it wasn't that he did it effortlessly. I had seen effortless from Aikido and Judo. It was that he did it contemptuously is the best word I have for it. There was never it didn't even seem like he was dealing with them, right? Or with the attack. He was just going, I don't have time for this. And he would walk and they would slam to the ground. And my first thought was, they're falling for him. There is no way. And then he did it to me. And I went, okay, I don't know what that is, but I want it. And so that's what drew me to CLOT from the get-go, was a very high expression and understanding of balance, how to disrupt it, how to get them off their feet. And it was the subtleties just amazed me. Guru Ken is an amazing teacher all the way around. But one of the things that I especially feel, what's the word I'm looking for? Grateful to him for, or grateful to myself really for training with him, because he couldn't really help this, is that he was a little guy. And as such, he didn't ever let me or any of the other big guys get away with cheating with our mass and muscle. Anytime he saw us using mass or muscle to accomplish the goal, the bounce, disruption, sweep, whatever, even if we did it and it worked, he would tell us, nope, that's no good. Do it again. And it really helped me understand how the stuff actually works, rather than just, yeah, I can make it fall down, but yeah, I'm a big guy. I can make people fall down. But it's something else, again, when you really understand it and can make them fall down with 20 pounds of pressure as opposed to 300 pounds, right?
Yeah, and that's a great insight. And I remember I had a student of mine that was, he was a big guy. He's a tall guy, 6 foot plus, you know. He must have been 250, 260. And I would catch him doing that because I'm relatively small. And he would do things on me, and they would, like you said, they would work, but I could feel him muscling it. And I remember always telling him, you know what, you're compensating and you'll get away with it with me until you run into a guy your size. And then what's going to happen? You got to really understand the principles, not just the muscle.
Exactly. And then Tai Chi, my experience, well, first my experience with Shen Chuan, which is not found much outside of East Texas, where it was founded. The founder's name is Professor Joe Lansdale. And his facility with balance disruption is mind-boggling. Even for me, and I have a really good understanding of balance disruption, Professor Lansdale and his guys, his senior guys, Coy Harry and Billy Jack and Horsham and a handful of others, they are just mind-boggling. And working with them and then my exposure to Tai Chi, it all helped sort of help me dig deeper into that understanding, find other expressions and nuances. You know, my first time at this Tai Chi retreat, and which was 2005, it's called Tai Chi Alchemy. I would highly recommend it to anyone who's interested. It doesn't even matter if you do Tai Chi. First time I went, I didn't do Tai Chi at all. I had no idea. But I went there because a friend of mine twisted my arm into it, and it was one of the most incredible events I've ever been to. But we were playing push hands, and I had never really done push hands. And this woman named Nancy, who is a very good Tai Chi practitioner and instructor in her own right, she asked me to do push hands. And we did, and we call her Wee Nan because she's not really sure how tall she is, but she's not very tall and she's not very big at all. And I think her top of her head comes probably does it to my upper chest, right? And we played for a little bit, and then she said, "Wow," she said, "I fully expected you to just sort of throw me across the room." I was like, "Well, no one learned anything that way, you know. If no one is surprised if, you know, the big 300-pound guy picks up the 150-pound woman and throws her across the room. Nobody learns anything." I was like, if I can disrupt the balance with my fingertips and a light touch, now we're learning something.
That sounds about right, Mike. Now, Mike, let me ask you this. Because a lot of the tribe members are heavily involved with weapons training, what kind of weapons are taught in your system? I know the answer to this, and I remember seeing the class you taught with a full grocery bag, which was just phenomenal. I mean, a great, you know, great memory of that class, because you were going to teach flexible weapons, and I remember, you know, half expecting you to come out with like a sarong or something similar, maybe a piece of rope or something, but you came out with a bag full of groceries. And
right.
You know, tell me about some of the weapons training in your system.
We do stick and knife, or sword and knife. It's mostly stick, but I do some sword based stuff, and flexible weapons. In flexible weapons, we commonly do train with a sarong, but I'm always trying to get people to understand that the sarong is just a training tool, just like a stick. You know, in reality, you might be dealing with a tire iron or a baseball bat instead of a stick. And in reality, you might be dealing with a grocery bag full of, you know, groceries or a laundry bag or a towel or whatever, a t-shirt or whatever, instead of the sarong. But yeah, that's with stick, knife, and flexible weapons are the weapons we deal with.
Now, Mike, one question here, because as you know, the Raven tribe is dedicated to teaching warriorship, and that doesn't always mean punching and kicking. And something you said earlier in the interview resonates, because you know, your approach to, you know, naming your system and the goals of your system of protecting yourself and others. And I saw a good quote. I can't tell you who I can attribute it to, but it basically said self-defense is learning how to protect yourself, and warriorship is learning how to protect others.
Yeah.
On a level past the physical, what kind of things are you trying to instill in your students? What are the elements from your perspective as far as developing warriors and teaching warriorship?
Well, on the physical level, you know, good balance, good coordination, good awareness, which is starting to leave the purely physical realm. But then the balance coordination also applied mentally, and emotionally for that matter. And so what I try to get students to understand, and I, you know, I use the mostly physical tools as the vehicle, but ultimately what I want students to develop is level head, even under heavy stress, a balanced mindset, so that they don't not to bring politics into this, but as an example, you know, I don't want, ideally, none of my students, and it has happened, but I always try and point it out to them. Ideally, none of my students are out there jumping on a bandwagon and not fact-checking, not verifying. They're going, wait, okay, I want to agree with this, but I don't know if this is true or not. So I want them to apply critical thinking. I want them to stop and like analyze before they jump to conclusions, whether it's about politics or religion or the martial arts video they just watched. Bring it back to martial arts. So often, and I just saw an example of it today, which is probably what's in my head. I see videos on YouTube or whatever, and there's all these comments about, well, that would never work, that's crap. And routinely, these videos are taken out of context. So I look at them and go, well, I don't know. Maybe the guy is teaching what not to do. I don't know. So I want my students to have that critical thinking, that balanced approach to things, and not always assuming this way is right because it jives with everything else, but is that actually right? Okay, maybe not. I think that's a large part of it. For me, when I hear the word warrior, I think of two things. One is my dad. My dad epitomized what I think of as a man, in the capital M sense of the word, and warrior. And that would be a long rabbit hole to go down to explain why I feel that way. But the other thing that comes to mind is this image that was given to me by a guy named, what is his name? His name will probably come to me in a minute. He was a Navy SEAL, retired. And he, at a presentation I saw him give, he said that his mental image of a warrior, and I stole this from him because it's such a powerful image, is a warrior, be it male or female, standing ready with a sword in one hand, cradling a sleeping infant in the other arm. And so, like, from that image, I find that an incredibly provocative image. And I get, you know, The warrior stands ready to protect, but is also nurturing. The infant feels so at peace in the warrior's arm that he or she can sleep without hesitation. It's a sort of a, you know, it's an absolute trust in the warrior's trust in him or herself, and the absolute trust of the infant in the warrior, and ultimately, and what's not shown in the image, but the absolute trust of the rest of the tribe, that the warrior is standing with sword in hand, ready to do battle, while the baby is in the arm.
Well, that's definitely a great visual. I mean, just to show the two extremes of what a person can be.
Yeah.
Excellent.
So I look for that. I want to foster that nurturing aspect. The guy. Well, I'll take a tangent here. You didn't ask the question, but I'll take a tangent real quick. In Indonesian Pencak Silat, the term for teacher is guru, G-U-R-U. And this term comes from old Sanskrit. And the gu is darkness, and ru is light. And when you put it together, it can be interpreted a lot of ways. The most basic is someone who brings someone from the darkness of ignorance into the light of understanding. So it might be a teacher of math, a teacher of language, a teacher of martial arts, whatever. But it also implies a guide who has come back down the trail, a trail they've already scouted, come back with a light source to guide other people farther down the trail, point out pitfalls, help them get where they're trying to get, whether it's the same destination as the guide had or not. And, so the guru is a guide, a mentor, a teacher, and all of those things and more. I think it's an incredibly lofty title. And I'm humbled to use it, but it's certainly what I aspire to and what I try to engender in my students.
That's an amazing explanation of the term. I've never heard that before, but it makes a lot of sense. And it does kind of set the bar for, you know, our own behavior as guides to other people.
Right. And tangentially, the Filipino term guro is the exact same root. But when guru arrived in the Philippines, the Filipino language at the time, Babayan, had no U sound or R sound. So the closest they could get was go, do, with a soft D. And so that evolved over time into guro.
Interesting. Nice history lesson, Mike. Well, Mike, before we wrap up here, please tell me where, because you've got a lot of fires going on. You've got your writing projects, your martial arts projects. Tell people where they can find you, where they can learn more about you, maybe order your book, hit you up for a class or a seminar. Where can we find you on the web?
TrainAGPS.com is my main website. You can search for my name on Facebook, and follow me through there. Through the website, they can get to my blog. I have a YouTube channel, AGPS Viz. It's currently somewhat underutilized, but it's out there and has some videos. Then let's see, and through my AGPS website, if you go to the merchandise section, you can find the book and videos that I have for sale. And also there's my entire curriculum is on the website with video links for each part of the curriculum. Through level one and level two. If someone wants to contact me, the easiest way is to click the contact link on the website. or find me on Facebook and shoot me a message. And yeah, I think that's pretty much it.
Great. Well, Michael, thank you very much for being on the show. I really appreciate you taking time out to talk with us, and hopefully we can get you on the show again in the near future, talk about, you know, some more martial arts and related topics to the warriorship. So again, thank you so much for being part of the show today. I really appreciate it, and I'm sure everybody out in the audience does as well.
Cool. Thank you.